Okay, answering the new atheism. In the first class, I introduced the movement known as the new atheism. And over the next 5 weeks, I responded to this fundamental and central claim of the new atheist that there are no rational reasons to believe that the claims of Christianity are true. That's really a central claim they make, a big thing they press, is that religion in general, Christianity in particular, is delusional. It's just based on beliefs and things that are fantasies. And so I spent the first five classes after the first one, so the first one and then the next five, answering that and trying to get you to see that there are in fact reasons for believing the claims of Christianity are true. And I argue that the existence of the universe, the existence of an objective moral standard, you're familiar with these, the existence of free will, the origin of life, the diversity of life, and the resurrection of Christ, all are reasons for believing in the existence of God. And of course, the evidence for Jesus' resurrection, that also is evidence for that specific and central element of the Christian faith, the resurrection of Jesus. Now this morning, I'm shifting away. I'm going to shift away from this charge of the new atheist that the claims of Christianity are groundless fantasies, that they're beliefs for which there is no supporting evidence. I've been looking at that. Now I'm going to shift away from that to other accusations that the new atheists bring or level against the Christian faith. And this will occupy us for a number of weeks. And the first of these claims involves what is known as the problem of evil. Now, the problem of evil, this is a long-standing challenge to belief that the God of the Bible exists. Okay, this is nothing new. This goes back at least to the Enlightenment, that this idea that evil somehow disproves the existence of the God of the Bible. And so naturally, some of the new atheists have adopted this and brought this into their arsenal of claims against Christianity. For example, Sam Harris. He points to the huge death toll in the tsunami in the Indian Ocean in 2004. And Daniel Dennett asserted in the Washington Post in January of 2010 that theists have no real solution to the problem of evil. So you see, they think that this has traction, and they raise this. Now, stated informally, here is the problem of evil. This is the argument from the problem of evil. Informally, the argument is that an all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good God would not allow evil to exist in His creation. That's the first premise, and that's the central, essential premise that is made. That an all-powerful, all-good, and all-knowing God would not allow evil to exist in His creation. And the idea, what's behind that, is look, it's because He's all-good, he would want to prevent evil from occurring in His creation. And because He's all-knowing, He would be aware of evil about to occur in His creation. And because He's all-powerful, He would be able to prevent evil from occurring. So it's that kind of thinking that leads to this premise, an all-good, all-knowing, all-powerful being. If that such a being existed, then evil wouldn't exist in the creation. He wouldn't let it exist. And then you have the second one, that evil does in fact occur or exist in the world. And then the conclusion follows logically from those premises. Therefore, an all-good, all-knowing, and all-powerful being, that is the God of the Bible, does not exist. Now, there's no doubt that evil exists in the world. You know, you have to be... I don't know how anybody can live and not understand that evil exists, but it does exist in the world. There's both moral evil and there is natural evil. Moral evil is the evil perpetrated by human beings, and it can be absolutely breathtaking. It can be breathtaking. I mean, the classic example, of course, is the is what was done to human beings in the concentration camps and gas chambers of Nazi Germany. Today we have ISIS doing things that you can look at that just take your breath away in terms of evil. So moral evil exists, and it is, just, you look at it and just go, man. And so that exists, but natural evil includes death, pain, and suffering inflicted by things like storms and volcanoes and earthquakes and floods and diseases and deformities. Now, these things have claimed the lives of millions, destroyed families, and caused untold suffering, physical, emotional suffering. So evil certainly exists in the world. Now, what can a Christian say when an atheist throws in the Christian's face, brings up the existence of evil, and demands to know how one can logically believe in the God of the Bible given the existence of all this evil? Does this evil prove that the God of the Bible does not exist? Well, as you might imagine, the answer is no. No, it doesn't. And first, let me point out, as you probably are ahead of me on this, but let me point out that in order to insist that certain occurrences in this world are evil, the atheist must assume that God exists. You see, in order to make that charge that there are things that are objectively evil, the atheist must assume that God exists. As I tried to point out earlier, if there's no God, then there is no objective evil. There's only matters of personal likes and dislikes. So from an atheistic perspective, from the atheist side of the lens, the death and suffering of human beings is no different than the melting of snow or the drying of grass. An atheist may not like it personally, but it's neither good nor bad. It simply is. Right? I mean, there is no objective morality. There's simply matter and law over time. So, if it fizzes this way, if it works out this way, you see, but they're upset and they're saying that here's this evil that exists, and to make that charge, they are implicitly assuming the existence of God. So you may have already spotted that. But the atheist argument, it can be properly addressed to us from within our own worldview. That's not illegitimate for them to do. In other words, even though they don't believe in God and have no basis for an objective morality, although it's hard to get them to see that, that's the reality. Even though that's the case for them, they can still say to us, look, given that you believe evil exists in the world, evil things occur in this world, how can you logically believe in the existence of an all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good God? In other words, the atheist can insist that our worldview is logically incoherent. It contains two things that cannot logically coexist: the God of Scripture and evil. So intellectual integrity, they would say, demands that we abandon our belief in God and join the atheist. Now, what they should say is join us in believing evil is an illusion, because that's all they could really say. But as I say, they have trouble seeing that. But they have no answer to this, right? I mean, their answer is all this suffering. Well, what's your answer? Well, it's not real. It only seems bad, but when we really think about it, it's no different than a flower being red or snow melting or grass drying. It's just what is. Well, that's not quite a solution, right? But they can say to us within our worldview, are you not holding to something that is logically incoherent? Now, the atheist is mistaken. The atheist is mistaken in thinking that the existence of evil is logically incompatible with the existence of God. See, even if a Christian cannot explain why God permits evil in the world, that's a different question. But even if the Christian cannot explain why God permits evil in the world, there's no contradiction between that evil and the existence of God, because God may have a morally sufficient reason for permitting it that we don't know. You see, so here it is, an all-good, all-knowing, all-powerful God, if an all-good, all-knowing, and all-powerful being existed, evil would not exist. That's quite a jump, you see. What if the all-good, all-knowing, all-powerful being had a morally sufficient reason for allowing evil to exist, but I just don't know it? Isn't that a logical possibility, that God has a morally sufficient reason, even if I don't know it? Are you telling me it is impossible that God could have a morally sufficient reason and me not know it? No. If God has a morally sufficient reason, you as a creature must be able to discern it. Well, that doesn't strike me as, that doesn't follow. You see, that doesn't follow, so that's where that breaks down. Now, that answer is not really emotionally satisfying. I understand that. To say that, no, logically, God may have a morally sufficient reason for permitting evil that I don't know, that's not really emotionally satisfying, and I have no problem with speculating and trying to discern and figure out, well, what are the reasons God has, the morally sufficient reasons God has? I have no problem with that, okay? But I just want you to see that it shows there's no logical inconsistency in the Christian worldview. The existence of evil does not logically negate the existence of the Christian God. Let me read you a quote from Alvin Plantinga. Plantinga is a very well-known Christian philosopher. And here's what he says in his book, God, Freedom, and Evil. He says, or suppose that the theist admits that he just doesn't know why God permits evil. What follows from that? Very little of interest. Why suppose that if God does have a good reason for permitting evil, the theist would be the first to know? Perhaps God has a good reason, but that reason is too complicated for us to understand. Or perhaps he has not revealed it for some other reason. The fact that the theist doesn't know why God permits evil is perhaps an interesting fact about the theist, but by itself it shows little or nothing relevant to the rationality of belief in God. Much more is needed for the atheological, the atheistic argument, even to get off the ground. The theist believes that God has a reason for permitting evil. He doesn't know what that reason is. But why should that mean that his belief is improper or irrational? To make out his case, therefore, the atheologian, the atheist, cannot rest content with asking embarrassing questions to which the theist does not know the answer. He must do more. He might try, for example, to show that's impossible or anyhow unlikely that God should have a reason for permitting evil. And I think this is important for us to understand, you see, when this idea is raised. You think of an infant, just as an example, as an illustration. You think of an infant whose parents must perform open-heart surgery on him to keep him alive. Now, that baby does not know and is incapable of understanding the things that justify and make right and loving the pain and suffering to which his parents are subjecting him. He has no idea. All he knows is, I'm getting the hammer in this deal. But he doesn't understand that and is incapable of understanding that. Is it too much to believe? Is it impossible to think or imagine that an infinite, omniscient God may know things that we don't know and perhaps are incapable of knowing, and that if we knew those things, we would understand how the suffering that we see is justified and how that suffering is right and loving? Is that too big of a stretch? to think that God may have that kind of reason? You can see that. Now, we get a glimpse of the principle in the Lord's horrific suffering on Golgotha. See, God in that one instance, God lifts the veil to show us a case of where he's bringing ultimate blessing out of savage cruelty. What could possibly be happening? Why would he allow that? There can be no reason, no justification. He lifts it and lets us see in this case. He lets us see what's going on. See, he did something through the evil that he allowed to be perpetrated on his son that we would never have imagined if he had not told us. We would never have understood and known that he had a tremendous, loving, morally sufficient reason for allowing the brutality on Jesus. But in that case, he told us. So we go, wow, we praise him for it. Right? We don't rebuke him and criticize him for it. We praise him for it. Well, that's the concept. So I want you to see that. Now, the Bible itself, in fact, it points in this direction regarding the problem of evil. This isn't something you say, well, you know, you're just kind of thinking through this. Well, I am thinking through it. But you also see that the Bible itself points in this direction regarding the problem of evil. That's what the book of Job is about. The book of Job is all about that when Job sought to know why he was suffering so horribly, when he knew that he was no greater sinner than the next man. Okay, Job is relatively righteous. He's not sinless, but he's relatively righteous. He is declared so. So we know that he is pious, sincere. You see, a righteous man. So he knows that I am not deserving of this compared to anybody else. You know, I'm no worse sinner than the next person for sure. So when he wants to know, why am I suffering like this? The loss of my family, the loss of my health, covered in boils, scraping things, just tremendous suffering. He wants to know, why? Well, God doesn't tell him the reason why. He doesn't come down. Now, we as the readers are privy to what Job is not. We see that there is a rationale going on in the heavenlies that allows Job to be a representative of God and to express his faith here as a special representative of God under the satanic assault. But Job's not told that. All Job knows is, I'm living my life and I'm suffering like a dog. And when he wants to know why, God doesn't come in and tell him and spell out why. That's not how God responds. Rather, he spoke to Job in the whirlwind, and he set before Job the greatness of his being. You say, well, wait a minute. I'm trying to understand, why am I suffering like this, and what does God do? He appears, speaks, and he sets before him the greatness of his being. The fact that he created the universe and that he knows all things. In Job 38, he says to him, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Job, you want to know. You're concerned. You want to know, how can this possibly be? Well, listen, Job. I spoke this reality into existence. Where were you, human being, dirt clumps? Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? And the idea, and he goes on like that. He sets before Job the greatness of his being, and the idea is, you're going to have to trust that I am who I am. You're going to have to trust who I am and that I'm big enough for the job, and you're just going to have to trust that the all-good God is in control and that there is a good and morally sufficient reason for your suffering. Now, you don't like that. You know, we want to say, I want to know the answers, and God simply says, what you have to rest in is the greatness of my being. Now, that's difficult to do. That's difficult, but that is the way of faith. that says, you know, I'd say everybody has experienced suffering, loss, these kinds of things, and you haven't been able to, you know, really put your finger on what is God doing in this. I've told ad nauseum the case of my friend from here who wound up losing his wife to breast cancer, and like the day after she died, his mother died unexpectedly from complications from surgery. It was Ron Burnett. And, his statement to me sometime after that was that reason doesn't reach far enough. And he just has to trust. See, even though he could not figure out, why am I left with two small children and no mother and wife? And left without a mother. But he just says, listen, I trust in the God who created all things and who has manifested his love to me. And that's how it is. Let me read to you a little poem. I've read this before, a couple of readings. I like it, and I think it's instructive. But I wrote this poem really to convey these concepts to children. Because I think children grow up, and we're afraid to try to teach them theology. And I think these things are important for us to have when we face suffering in the world, so that we have the right perspective on it. And I think it's important for children. The poem's titled Julius Bings. The garden teemed with living things, none so content as Julius Bings. He'd sing atop the willow tree that no bird was as blessed as he. My nest is fine, I've much to eat. My wife and kids are safe and sweet. Each day I wake without a care, because I'm good and life is fair. From time to time, the owl would say that things don't always work that way. But Julius Bings would never hear, convinced that harm could not come near. He thought bad things could only be for those who were much worse than he. One summer day, a storm moved in. Thick darkness fell upon the glen. So great the wind that blew that day, nary a tree stood in its way. And when the storm at last did part, none was left of Julius's heart. For in the rubble he could see the nest that housed his family. Oh, why, he said with tears, I have done right all these years. He asked the owl how this could be, who said it was a mystery. The hand that gave the tree and nest, life and family and the rest, he who is the Ancient of Days is far too great to know his ways. A peace is all that we can see. He knows the final tapestry. For now he lets creation bring much heartache through this kind of thing, and suffers with us as we cry and hear no answer as to why. But all is headed for a goal where suffering will have no role. On that day, we'll finally know the reason why so much was so. We trust his love through all the loss, for only love would bear a cross. Julius cried for many a day, but held to what the owl did say. After a time, he sang anew, but did so with a deeper view. In pain, he learned a lesson dear, that through it all, the Lord was near. Now, I think, see, this is a perspective that ought to be conveyed to people growing up, to see that what you see a lot on television, the idea that Christianity is this bubble that insulates you from a fallen world, is not right. And if people don't have categories and ways of thinking about suffering, when it strikes them, it can be devastating to them. So that was what motivated me in writing that. Now, this problem of evil, it can't be viewed, by the way, in isolation from the other evidence in favor of God's existence. In other words, the fact that on this particular, we have to play defense and say it's possible God has a reason for allowing evil that I don't know, that's not all there is to say about it, is there? So he says, no, this shows God doesn't exist. He says, well, wait a minute. That's not the end of the story. This argument that you're making doesn't occur in a vacuum. We have good reasons for believing in God that far outweigh our inability to explain all his ways. There are plenty of reasons for believing in God. So you raise something here that I may have to play defense on, but that one argument doesn't stand alone. There's plenty of reasons for believing in God. Now, the new atheists are very fond of charging God with immorality. See, they raise the problem of evil. That's one of the things they glom onto and present. But they're also big on charging God, saying that God is a moral monster. You can see this, in fact. You get a flavor of their anger toward God in Richard Dawkins' oft-quoted statement from the book The God Delusion. Dawkins says, the God of the Old Testament is arguably the most unpleasant character in all of fiction. Jealous and proud of it. A petty, unjust, unforgiving control freak. A vindictive, bloodthirsty ethnic cleanser. A misogynistic, homophobic, racist, infanticidal, genocidal, filicidal, pestilential, megalomaniacal, sadomasochistic, capriciously malevolent bully. And he's very proud of this. I've seen him, refer to this a number of times. He thinks this is all very clever. According to Christopher Hitchens, the Old Testament contains, quote, a warrant for trafficking of humans, for ethnic cleansing, for slavery, for bride price, and for indiscriminate massacre. Now, you have to notice again, right, that in order for the atheist to charge God with being evil, which they love to do, but in order to do that, they have to assume that objective evil exists. They've got something to say about it. That there is evil out there and God is violating that. Well, then to do that, they have to assume the existence of God. Otherwise, you say, okay, what do you care? Snow melts, grass dries, some flowers are red, some are blue. Buildings fall on people, people cut people's heads off. You see? And so they have to borrow that, idea from a theistic worldview. And it almost gets surreal, because from their standpoint, you see, they're complaining about bad things being done by a non-existent being. So it's almost, you say, wait a minute, you're over here getting worked up and making these challenges about a being you claim doesn't exist, but whose existence you have to assume to make the charge. So it just gets really surreal. But let's just focus on the challenges from within a Christian worldview. And the real claim, it seems to me, what they're really saying is that if the God of Scripture exists, he's not worthy of being worshipped. That seems to me to be the gist of the complaint, of the argument. That if he exists as you claim, then from your own Scriptures, he's unworthy of worship because he is a moral monster. Well, let's look at some of these claims. One of the things they like to say is that God is prideful. He's narcissistic and he's vain. God is not prideful, narcissistic, and vain. Pride is having a false and inflated view of oneself. See, somebody who cannot play basketball very well, but who thinks he's the next Michael Jordan. You see, that person is prideful. Now, if LeBron James said he couldn't play basketball very well, that would be a false humility. You see, that would be a false humility because that's not true. But if he refused to acknowledge God as the source of his gifts, he would be prideful then for taking credit for God's work. But I want you to see here, like if James says, look, I can play basketball, he's not being prideful. God has an accurate view of himself. He doesn't have a distorted view, an inflated view, a deceptive view. He has an accurate view of himself. And the truth is that he's the greatest conceivable being, and for that reason, he's worthy of worship. That's the reality. You can't sit here and say, no, I'm going to say God isn't this thing, and when he claims to be that, he's being prideful. No, he is that. He is that. He's the greatest conceivable being. The fact God made humans in his image, that's not an act of vanity. He's got, oh, that's just being vain. I made him in my image. No, it's an expression of his kindness. It's an expression of his kindness. He shared some of his characteristics with us and thereby gave us the privilege of being able to relate to him so we can serve as his representatives over creation. So he shares some of his characteristics with us. That allows us, see, to interact with him in a way. So that's kindness. That's not vanity. And God insists that we worship him. Like, what? You can't say, you know, if anybody did that, they'd be on an ego trip. Listen to me. I've actually heard people who are believers say this kind of thing, which I take as borderline blasphemous. God's certainly not on an ego trip. He insists that we worship him not only because it's right and proper to do so. It is inherently right and proper to worship God because of who he is. You see, as a child's respect for his or her parents is right and proper. That's right and proper inherently. But not only is that the case, God insists that we worship him not only because it's right and proper, but also because he wants us to stay attached to him for our own good. He is the ultimate reality. He is the ultimate reality. And if we lose sight of that truth, and if we begin to construct a fantasy world that denies that he is the ultimate reality, we will suffer harm. If we start to take him from the throne and say, no, he's not really the ultimate reality, the creator of all things, and we start to construct these false alternate realities, that will wind up harming us. See, worship, as we might say, helps to keep our mind right. You see, it's not only inherently proper because of God's glory and greatness, but it also is a blessing to us because it helps to keep our mind right. It helps to keep us focused on who he is as the ultimate reality, so we don't construct false alternate realities, which would be harmful for us. So it is a blessing to us in the relationship of the members of the Godhead. God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit is one of ego-free, self-giving love. And God's humility and God's self-giving, it's put beyond question, is it not? In the coming of God the Son to become a human, to serve mankind, and to give his life a ransom for many. People think, well, God's on an ego trip, and I'm thinking, do you know the story of the Bible? Do you know that this one you're claiming of being on an ego trip became a human being and allowed human beings to spit on him and to beat him? Why did he do that? Why did he come to serve us and give his life a ransom for many? Who can tell me? That is the ultimate of humility. And I got to listen to these people. It's like, oh. You just go, come on, you're killing me with this stuff. How do you even raise these kinds of questions? Well, another thing they like to say is that God's jealousy and his anger at spiritual infidelity, he's immoral. Jealousy, you see, that's something that's really bad. People like Dawkins, and you can throw into this Oprah Winfrey and Bill Maher, they can condemn God for his being jealous toward his people. They claim this makes him petty and insecure. You see, it's like, you know, what do you think? This is like a junior high school kind of thing? Is that how you're perceiving this? It makes him petty and insecure? That's not the case. See, God's jealousy, his jealousy is not rooted in self-centeredness. It springs from his concern for the covenant and for the welfare of his covenant partners. There is a sinful kind of jealousy. I mean, everybody knows that, right? Who can read? You see it in Romans 13:13, 1 Corinthians 3:3, 2 Corinthians 12:20, Galatians 5:20, James 3:14, 16, and on and on. But as Paul makes clear in 2 Corinthians 11:2, there is a different kind of jealousy. There is a godly jealousy, or a divine jealousy, a jealousy that is motivated by concern for other people, and that jealousy is a virtue. That's why Paul says to them, I have a godly jealousy. Why? It's because I'm motivated by your well-being, and that's what is driving this. God is jealous for us because he despises the idea of us, the objects of his love, being lured away from him who is life and satisfaction, who is the fountain of living waters, being lured away from him to worthless and destructive substitutes. He cares enough about his covenant and his people to get angry when they break it. Here's what philosopher Paul Copen says in his book, Is God a Moral Monster? A marriage without the potential for jealousy when an intruder threatens isn't much of a marriage. Now you think about that. Anybody who just yawns when a third party interloper is trying to come into that covenant arrangement, just what do I care? You know, no big deal to me. That is something that says that covenant is not meaningful to you. He says, with the marriage without the potential for jealousy when an intruder threatens isn't much of a marriage. Outrage, pain, anguish, these are appropriate responses to such a deep violation. God isn't some abstract entity or impersonal principle, as Dawkins seems to think he should be. He is an engaging, relational God who attaches himself to humans. He desires to be their loving father and the wise ruler of their lives. In Israel's case, God's love is that of a passionate husband. We should be amazed that the creator of the universe would so deeply connect himself to human beings that he would open himself to sorrow and anguish in the face of human betrayal and rejection. See, this is the way to think of it. It's not like I'm looking at Dawkins, they were sitting here, well, you know, he's jealous. Just take a word out, not a concept that's behind the word. Jealous, okay, I can make that sound bad. You see, and then I can sell it to people who then go, really, that's right, God's jealous, bad. Say, no, you have to think about these things. You see, you have to see, well, what does it mean? What is God's jealousy? And that's an important thing, to recognize that. They sometimes like to say, the new atheists in charging God with being a moral monster, that he's a child abuser. He's a child abuser. This is a lead, they're the two prongs they like to work on this is with Abraham and Isaac and with the crucifixion of Jesus. That's why they level this charge. He's a child abuser. When God tested Abraham by telling him in Genesis 22:2 to offer his son Isaac as a burnt offering, he intended all along to stop him before he actually killed Isaac. You say, okay, I understand that, but was he still commanding Abraham to do something immoral? After all, God says clearly elsewhere that child sacrifice is an abomination. Deuteronomy 12:31, 18:10, 2 Kings 16:3. So was he still commanding Abraham to do something that was immoral? Well, in this case, you see, it was understood. It was understood by Abraham based on God's repeated promises and assurances that Isaac would grow up to adulthood so as to be the one through whom God's promise to bring a great nation from Abraham would be fulfilled. So God had promised and assured Abraham that Isaac would grow to adulthood so as to be the one through whom those promises would be fulfilled. So what does Abraham know? He says, I know one thing, that if it turned out that I'm to go ahead through this, God's bringing him right back to life. So it's not a death in that sense. It's like walk through here, you'd be dead and you're alive. You see, so even if even if, you see, he's going to bring him right back to life. And Abraham knows that. And he knows that, and you can see, you remember that in Genesis 22:5, when he tells the servants, as he heads to Mount Moriah with Isaac, we will worship, and then we will come back to you. Well, what's he thinking already? He already knows. He says, I don't know how this is all going to play out. God has told me to do this, but I know something else. God has told me and repeatedly told me and assured me that Isaac's going to grow to adulthood. I don't know how it's going to work out, but I trust God. If it turns out that I wind up doing this, then God is apparently going to bring him right back to life, because we're coming back. That's what he says there. And in fact, the writer in Hebrews 11:19 says flatly that Abraham in that situation considered that God was able even to raise the dead. Okay, so you see then that the killing there wouldn't be a traditional classic killing of what? I kill you, you're dead. It would be something where I have you go through this, and then what? You're alive. So there's a difference there. There's a difference, and it's one that is significant. So is it immoral for God to command Abraham to offer Isaac as a sacrifice when he was going to stop him before he did it? When Abraham knew that even if God didn't stop him, he promptly was going to bring Isaac back to life. And when Abraham's trust in God through this test of faith would be used to bless countless people throughout history as an example of faith. Is it immoral for God to do that? It is not. If you weren't God and you didn't know what you were doing and going to stop it, or as Abraham thought, bring him right back to life, and weren't going to use this in the flow of salvation history to bless countless people through this example, well, then it'd be a different argument. But we have to take it as it is. So this idea that that's somehow child sacrifice is wrong. The next one is they talk about the Lord Jesus, which is simply crazy, saying that, characterizing that as child abuse. But that's where I'll pick up next week. I heard that bell. Thank you.